All right, well, we'll go ahead and get started. I want to thank everyone for coming today and joining our virtual stormwater rate study listening session. I'm going to be going over a couple key items. This is a recorded meeting. We will not be recording cameras or the chat, but the presentation and the audio will be recorded. We will post the recording of the presentation on our Clean Water Fee webpage within 10 business days. Everyone will remain muted and our chat feature is enabled. So if you think of a question during the presentation, go ahead, type it on in and send it through the chat. We will read it aloud during the question and answer session of the presentation. To be considerate of everyone's time, we will adhere to our time frame and will not go past the 8 p.m. mark. If there isn't enough participation or questions, we will go ahead and end the meeting early. If there are any unanswered questions in the chat, we will pass them along to the staff. Please remember, this is your time to ask us questions. Email addresses will be provided at the end of the presentation and will also be available on our webpage. Title VI forms and a comment form will be emailed to everyone in attendance within the next couple of days. These items are optional. With that being said, I'll go ahead and pass it over to our Clean Water Division Manager, Devin, to kick off the presentation.
Thank you, Haley, and good evening, everybody. My name is Devin Rostfer, and I am the Clean Water Division Manager in Public Works, and I am so excited to be here tonight to share with you all the outcomes from our 2025 to 2029 stormwater rate study. But before we get started, there are many members of our Clean Water and Public Works team here today that I would like to give a moment to introduce themselves, starting with our director, Ken.
Good evening, everyone. I want to thank you especially for joining us this evening. I know it takes extra energy to be with us in the evening like this, and we're really happy to have you with us. I'm the Public Works Director here at the county, and Clean Water, our program is one of our 8 divisions at the county. So we're up to a lot of different things, but the Clean Water team is a small and very mighty team of individuals that you're going to learn about tonight. So thank you for joining us, and I'll hand it back to Devin. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Jeff?
Yeah, thanks, Devin. Good evening, everyone. My name is Jeff Schnabel. I am part of the Clean Water Division team. I manage our stormwater infrastructure programs for Public Works.
Thanks, Jeff. Let's go to Andrea.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Andrea Logue with the Clean Water team, and I am the financial lead for the division with work including the stormwater fee. And as well as budget and forecasting. Glad to have you here.
Thanks, Andrea. And last but not least, Eric.
Hi, I'm Eric Lambert. I'm the outreach specialist for Clark County Public Works, and I make sure that we're meeting our education and outreach requirements under our stormwater permit.
Great. For today's presentation, we have 4 main objectives that we want to get through in our short time together. First, we're going to start with some background information on what is the Clean Water Division, and second, what clean water services does the Clean Water Division provide in Clark County? Additionally, we will go over how clean water services are paid for. And finally, we'll go over our stormwater rate study for 2025 to 2029 and the results that have come out of that study. But the main objective for today is really a chance to hear from all of you. As we've completed the stormwater rate study and we've identified what services we think are most important to provide to Clark County residents, what we want to hear from you is what clean water services are most important to all of you, and make sure that we didn't miss anything and hear what you would like to focus, what you would like to see our division focus on for the next 5 years. So without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Eric Lambert to talk a bit more about the Clean Water Division. Eric?
All right. Thanks, Devin. In these next couple of slides, I want to show you a little bit about who we are as a Clean Water Division, the type of work that we do, and then I'll get into a little bit more about some of the different topic areas we focus on. And we have a small but mighty team, as our director mentioned. We have a staff of 18 with two of us actually in other divisions full-time supporting clean water work. And in the next few slides, we'll kind of get a feel for all the things that we do. Now, to clarify what type of water we're talking about, because there are three different water utilities, and I like to think of it, the water coming into your house, and that's the drinking water, the water going out of your house, and that's the wastewater, and then the water falling on your house. And that's the water that we're talking about. We're talking about stormwater. And the number one, maybe the thing you think of most might be, you know, making sure that the streets aren't flooded and providing drainage. But there are also a number of regulatory requirements that came about as a result of the 1972 Clean Water Act. The Clean Water Act is a federal law, and the federal government appoints an agency in each state, and in our state, it's the Department of Ecology, to manage and make sure that jurisdictions are adhering to the Clean Water Act. Now, you may ask yourself, what does a city or a county have to do with the Clean Water Act? Because I thought that was about cleaning up big polluters. And you're right. That was really what it was about. That was when the Cuyahoga River was catching fire multiple times because of pollution. And this Clean Water Act did a lot to clean up those polluters. But as a city or a county, in our case, we own the conveyance system that moves stormwater. And so from the catch basin through the pipes that convey that water to our local streams, that's our ownership. And so as a result of us essentially discharging that stormwater that picks up pollutants along the way into our streams, we also have a stormwater permit. And so let's get into some of the services that we provide. And the first one here that I'll get to is capital planning and project implementation. So that includes new projects that we build to improve water quality in our community. It also includes retrofitting areas where we might need to have some improvements. And so that's one big piece of our work. And of course, when you build that type of infrastructure, you need to maintain it. And so this is work that we're inspecting and maintaining thousands of catch basins throughout the county, our own stormwater facility, stormwater infrastructure that we own, including stormwater facilities like detention ponds and rain gardens throughout the community. And so that's a lot of work as well. We also have a role with stormwater planning and coordination. We have to plan and coordinate with neighboring jurisdictions because sometimes there's connections between our stormwater infrastructure, but we also form partnerships to become more efficient and more effective in educational strategies or lake management strategies. And so that's another piece of our work. Now, how do we prioritize and how do we know if we're making a difference? We also have a monitoring and assessment team, and these are folks that are scientists that are measuring water quality and looking at different indicators in streams to understand and help us prioritize about where we should be focusing our efforts. Inspections is a big piece. Our stormwater permit requires that our stormwater facilities need to be inspected annually, and some of this is with our folks inspecting privately owned stormwater facilities, but we also have to inspect the stormwater infrastructure that we own as well. And so, as I mentioned, there are thousands of different things out in the community that we need to inspect on an annual basis. We know that businesses play a big role in helping to prevent pollution. And so we have pollution prevention specialists and also called source control specialists who are out in the community and talking with businesses, providing technical assistance, really trying to be a partner with businesses to help them find out ways to protect water quality and prevent pollution. We have a lot of infrastructure, as I've mentioned a few times, but where is it all? Much of it is under the ground. And so we have an extensive mapping system through our GIS system that helps us identify the locations so that folks that are out in the field whether they're inspecting or maintaining or repairing different parts of our infrastructure, are able to find it. And so this is a big part of really the background stuff that allows us to do the work that we do. And lastly, education and outreach. As we mentioned before, we've cleaned up some of the big polluters. And so how is pollution still happening in our waterways? Well, a lot of times it's our everyday activities. And so it's really important to be able to educate our community, from students all the way up to adults, about ways that they can protect water quality in their everyday activities. And so those are really the key areas that we focus our energy in, that small team. And after that, I'll pass it over to Jeff to talk about some of our challenges.
Great, thanks, Eric. So as Eric went through, we do a lot of different things. We have a lot of great staff, and we got a lot of great partners to help us do some of this work. So we accomplish a lot. We try to do it as efficiently as we can. But as time goes by, we still do face some challenges as we look over the next 5-year period going forward. Chief among them, the whole name of the game with this is compliance. So like Eric was saying, we have this permit that comes out from the state under the Clean Water Act. And so many of the things that we are worried about accomplishing all the time are just filling those requirements, meeting those requirements. So new regulatory requirements come out with each permit cycle. We just started, in fact, our new 5-year permit cycle from the state. Each time we do that, we have an increase in our requirements. There's new or expanded projects that we need to be taking care of as we go forward. Our infrastructure is aging. Eric mentioned we have an awful lot of pieces of infrastructure out there. A lot of our really important assets are reaching or exceeding 30 years old, and that's a time frame at which we start seeing a greater need for larger repairs. And among those infrastructure needs, the repair and maintenance of our underground pipes is a new priority that we really want to push in the next few years. The pipes are out of sight, but they're extremely important for moving stormwater around. We do not have a routine inspection or maintenance program for pipes right now. It's on an as-needed basis or a complaint-driven basis. We don't want to see too many situations like depicted in this picture. This did not happen to be a stormwater pipe, but this was a water pipe that broke last year in Vancouver. We just don't want to be seeing too many of those situations with our storm system. Next, please. Managing and planning for growth. If you drive around the county at any level, you'll notice that growth is happening, and it's happening very rapidly and very consistently in the county. Part of what we do under Clean Water is managing the Clark County Stormwater Manual. And that manual regulates how stormwater infrastructure is built and implemented throughout the county as we build subdivisions and roads to accommodate more population. We're right in the middle now of a new update to that manual that'll be happening over the next 2 years. Next, please. Salmon recovery needs are increasing. Obviously an iconic species, a center point species for the Pacific Northwest. So we're always looking to prioritize our actions to see where we can support those salmon recovery processes more appropriately. Next. Climate's also changing. As we get wetter winters and more intense rainfall, particularly, how do we prioritize our efforts to make our systems more resilient so that they're not overwhelmed by those events when they do happen? And lastly, there's been a renewed interest and public desire for lake management, particularly Lacamas Lake and Vancouver Lake in the county. Clean Water has been asked to participate in some of those management activities, and we're looking forward to doing so. And I think that is where I will hand it off to Andrea.
Thank you, Jeff. So how does Clark County pay for clean water and all the services we provide? So Clean Water Fund 4420 is a fund that is separate from the general fund, and it finances the operations, maintenance, and capital improvements of Clark County's stormwater infrastructure. So it is an enterprise fund, which means it's an account for business type activities. It is operated and funded in a manner that is similar to private business enterprises, where the costs to provide the continuous services to the general public are recovered primarily through user charges. So the goal is cost recovery. And in 2023, which is the last full year of data, just over 79,000 properties were billed. It's just a small increase from 2022. And we collected approximately $7.6 million in revenue. Next slide, please. So staff across multiple Clark County departments work together on the stormwater fee, which is called the clean water fee. Public Works and the auditor's office conduct six-year budget forecasting to monitor if the clean water fund has a surplus or a deficit. The assessor's office assesses taxes. GIS uses the assessor's data to calculate the fees, and the treasurer's office bills and collects the fees. Next slide, please. So the foundation is, or how are clean water fees calculated? And the foundation is the rate structure. And so the rate structure, on a high level overview, is that it designates property in unincorporated Clark County by answering two questions. Is the property inside or outside the urban growth area? And is it residential or non-residential? So in this depiction of an equation, we have the annual stormwater rate. And so it's $47 inside the urban growth area and $35 outside the urban growth area. And then it is multiplied by the base unit. So the base unit for residential property is one house is equivalent to one unit. But for non-residential property, the fee is charged based on the property's total impervious area divided by 3,500 square feet to equal one unit. So this results in units that are equivalent to residential units. And for example, if the total impervious area on a site is 3,500 square feet, and you divide that by the base unit of 3,500 square feet, the result is one unit. But let's say now the impervious surface area is 35,000, and then you divide that by the base unit of 3,500 square feet, the result is 10 units. So now we go back to the beginning of the equation. Let's say this property is inside the UGA, so $47 multiplied by those 10 units would equate to the clean water fee amount that would be billed, which would be $470. And so if you're looking for more information on your clean water fee and how to submit any questions, please go ahead and visit our clean water fee page. And so then if we can have the next slide, please. So the treasurer's office bills and collects the clean water fees via the property tax statements, with payments due in April and October of each year. There are currently several options to make billing and collecting clean water fees more equitable. So bills over $50 can be paid in two increments. There are exemptions for property owners who are senior citizens or who are disabled. And then hardship mobile homes are not billed. Next slide, please. So why a rate study now? Stormwater fee rates were last increased in 2015. And there has only been one increase since 2000, which is the first year stormwater fee rates were assessed. The fund balance is diminishing, because now we've slid over this tipping point where the costs to provide the services are more than the revenues received from this 2015 fee rate. Next slide, please. And so now I'm going to turn it over to Jeff to talk more about the stormwater rate study.
Okay, so we embarked at the beginning of 2024 in January on our rate study kickoff. So this is just a quick slide about where we've been over the past 9 months or so. We kicked off this effort with council in January. We've had several touch points and several conversations with the Clark County Council and various other folks over the course of this time. February was a time where we formed our core team, finance folks, various people from the county, and conducted a bunch of departmental and interdepartmental interviews with our service providers and those who are helping us implement these programs. March was identifying gaps in our services and estimating our funding needs going forward. We also had a public survey at that time, which maybe you had a chance to fill out to begin to get an idea of what the public's wishes are and the types of services that are most important to folks. In May, we were back with the council and sharing the results of our public survey, as well as gathering information on which of the stormwater services are most important to council themselves. And then finally, in July, we brought our predicted funding needs for the 2025 to 2029 time period to council, talked about some revenue assumptions that we developed, and worked through our draft rates and the range of rates that we might be looking at with them as well. That then led up to our listening sessions that you are a part of here in September. So what have we learned over that time period? There we go. Well, we've learned that the costs for clean water services have gone up. No surprises, it's kind of a familiar story that we hear a lot. You know, over time, the cost to deliver things increases. We have had the same stormwater rates for a lengthy period of time. The last adjustment to the rates was in 2015. And prior to that, the last time the rates were adjusted was when they were initiated in the year 2000. So we've got a couple of things that are really heavy drivers of this increase in cost as we've gone through these exercises. Particularly inspections, operation, and maintenance really rises to the top as far as the reason we have a lot of needs. So we've got a little over $300 million worth of infrastructure out there in the stormwater world, publicly owned. That includes 2,000 treatment and flow control facilities dealing with water, made up of over 50,000 individual inspectable and maintainable assets out there. So we do have a requirement to inspect 95% of our infrastructure every single year. And then we have required timeframes under that stormwater permit that Eric talked about, within which we need to repair those systems. Next, please. And then just a couple more examples of some of the infrastructure we have out there. We have about 600 bioretention facilities, also known as rain gardens to some. You'll notice them along the edges of many of our arterial roads. They're the little cutout vegetated strips. We have over 500 stormwater ponds that we need to maintain. We have the aforementioned 500 or so miles of pipe that we'd really like to begin doing some proactive maintenance and inspection of. We've got a bunch of properties that we own that we don't have the resources to maintain as much as we'd like, particularly when it comes to mowing, things like fire breaks and making sure that we're keeping brush and things back from folks' homes adjacent to those properties. We have about 1,600 dry wells. Those are specialized manholes that take treated stormwater and discharge it directly into the ground, into the groundwater to replenish that. We're looking to try to ramp up so we can inspect those annually and make sure they're doing what they're supposed to be doing. We've been talking mostly about public stormwater, but we also have a lot of private stormwater systems out there, over 1,800 of those facilities, and we are obligated as clean water program to inspect and regulate the maintenance of those as well. So we do maintain a relationship with all those private owners and inspect their infrastructure annually. And then we have over 200 of our facilities that are already in that 30 year old or older category for potentially major maintenance. And every 5 years going forward, we expect to see another 250 or so fall into that category of 30 years or greater. So those are just some of the things kind of driving some of the things we're talking about with council and some of the needs that we may have. Next, please. Okay, so as we've gone through these exercises and talked about our level of service and talked about our rate study, we've differentiated the services that we can provide or want to provide into three different categories. So we've got our mandated, recommended, and additional services. Under the mandated services, those are what we consider our base level of service. So these are the items that are necessary for us to remain compliant with the Clean Water Act, the stormwater permit, those expectations that we can't really ignore. So those are mandated services as we talk about these service provisions. Recommended services are the next level. They're a kind of a proactive level of service where we want to prevent infrastructure failure, extend the life of our infrastructure, kind of long-term asset management work to improve our function and mitigate public safety risks that could get worse if we just push off all of our maintenance and stuff until something breaks. So over time, these recommended proactive level of service can save a lot of money just because it's a lot easier to proactively fix something than to wait until it causes a lot of damage and then have to work on all of that. And then the final category, additional services, are what we consider kind of our highest level of service, which are some optional type of things that the public and the council may find very important. Things like expanding our reforestation programs or working more to enhance salmon recovery or watershed health programs, or possibly even doing more stormwater retrofits above and beyond what our permit requires. So again, keep that in mind as we're talking through things, those three kind of recommended, mandated, recommended, and additional levels of service. Next up. So for that 25 to 29 period, we identified 62 services that we would like to be able to provide. 30 of them fall into that mandated category, which are really not optional things. 22 are in that proactive recommended service level, and then an additional 10 that are kind of that high level. Next, please. All right. I think I'll turn it to Devin at this point.
Thank you, Jeff, for that great overview. Now I'm going to transition to talking about how do these proposed new and enhanced services for 2025 to 2029 affect stormwater rates. First, I'll start a little bit with telling you about how we get to revise stormwater rates. Currently, the Clean Water Division has a public hearing scheduled with Clark County Council on October 1st, 2024, where we are requesting Council to consider adoption of the 2025 to 2029 stormwater rate study and the fixing of stormwater rates and charges for this duration. Council is being asked to select a potential rate increase based on the clean water services that they would like us to provide. And like Jeff explained, these include services in the mandated category, the recommended category, or the additional category. And the Clean Water Division is proposing that we establish a flat rate for the next 5 years and that we revisit rates every 5 years, consistent with our stormwater permit renewal cycle. As a result of the 2025 to 2029 stormwater rate study, we are proposing and requesting Council to consider increasing our existing stormwater rate, which is currently $47 per year, to a rate between $64.86 to $86.48. And this range, where we land in this range depends on whether or not County Council decides to support a rate increase that will pay for mandated versus recommended versus additional services or a combination of those. When looking at what this rate increase equates to monthly, currently our existing annual rate of $47 a year, which has been enacted since 2015, equates to about $3.91 a month. And essentially, we wanted to show this comparison to make it real for families in Clark County of what our rate increase could potentially look like. And approximately the monthly breakdown of the proposed rate increase for 2025 to 2029 would land us somewhere between $5.41 a month to $7.21 a month, pending council approval. And what this equates to essentially is about the price for one of your favorite fall drinks, a pumpkin spice latte from a local coffee shop, or a colossal burger monthly from our local Burgerville. And while we know that these are luxurious items, we share these examples of what a stormwater rate could look like in Clark County to really demonstrate that our team believes that we can achieve multiple stormwater services for a fairly low price. So this slide shows a summary of the different potential proposed annual rates that Clark County Council will consider on October 1st. In orange, you will see the highest rate that we are asking council to consider for mandated, recommended, and additional services. What this new rate would result in is implementation of 62 new and enhanced services total by the Clean Water Division. This would include not only the mandated base level of service to be in compliance with regulatory requirements, but also would enable our division to implement proactive services that help us prevent infrastructure failure and extend the useful life of infrastructure, really focusing on those activities that will enable us to inspect underground infrastructure and begin to implement proactive maintenance activities over time. And finally, this highest rate at $86.48 a year would also enable us to make progress on essential activities such as reforestation, salmon recovery, and investments that help us make progress on watershed health. Shown in the lime green is the middle range rate that we're asking council to consider. While we think our division would be able to make significant investments at this level, unfortunately, if council decided to support the $80.84, we wouldn't be able to make progress on the reforestation and salmon recovery efforts, but we believe there's still a significant amount of progress that we could make on protecting and investing in our stormwater assets. And then the lowest rate that we'd ask council to consider increasing our rate to is shown in the dark blue, which is also a significant improvement in the opportunity for our team to continue to provide excellent services that keep us in compliance with the Clean Water Act and the stormwater permit. I do want to share a graph that shows how does Clark County's current stormwater rate and proposed stormwater rates compare to neighboring jurisdictions. So what you see on the screen, shown in orange, is Clark County's current annual stormwater rate of $47. And in green, these are the proposed rates that we are requesting council to consider for 2025 to 2029. What you see in the dark blue and in the gray are what neighboring jurisdictions in Clark County are currently charging, what they were charging in 2023 for stormwater. And as you can see, Clark County has consistently been the lowest in Clark within our region, but also in Western Washington. And that is something that we're proud of, and we want to keep rates low for our ratepayers. As we know, expenses have been going up everywhere. And what you'll see is that with our proposed rates for 2025 to 2029, we still intend to remain the lowest in Clark County and in Western Washington. The nearest rate to what we're currently proposing for Clark County is the City of LaCenter and City of Ridgefield, which unincorporated Clark County would still be significantly lower than. So as a reminder, as we wrap up our presentation today, our goal for increasing the rate in 2025 to 2029 is really to catch up. As we mentioned earlier, the cost to provide to stormwater services have increased over time. However, our rate has stayed the same, which puts us in an unfortunate structural deficit situation. Our goal as a Clean Water Division is to provide the best clean water services as possible to residents of Clark County and to make sure that we have enough funding to provide essential public services. As far as next steps, we are happy to be here today having this community listening session with you all. And we have one final community listening session this Thursday at the Salmon Creek Elementary School. We also have a final work session with council where we will present our final draft rates, before we ask them to formally consider adopting the results from the 2025 to 2029 stormwater rate study and the fixing of stormwater rates and charges on October 1st, 2024 during a public hearing. Any rate increase that may or may not be supported by Clark County Council would not come into effect until February of 2025. Once again, I want to thank everyone for taking time to spend a portion of your evening with us today. And we want to show you how you can stay up to date on our clean water rate study and the services that our clean water division intends to provide over the next 5 years. So we do have a website where you can go and learn more about our clean water fee. And we also have a YouTube channel where you can go and view previous work sessions with County Council that we've been holding since January on the stormwater rate study. And we also have a social media webpage. You can find us on Facebook and other social media platforms. And before we get into the facilitated discussion and time where we really get to hear from you, we did want to share that public outreach and hearing from the community has been essential. We deemed it very important from the beginning of this rate study process. And earlier this year, we put out a public survey to hear from residents in Clark County what clean water services matter most to you. Why are clean water, or why are clean rivers, lakes, and streams important to residents of Clark County? And we took the time to translate this survey into Russian, Ukrainian, Spanish, and Vietnamese, and we shared it broadly across our networks. And what we heard from the community is that 84% of survey respondents felt that Clark County's ability to protect clean water needs improvement, which is essentially what we are hoping to achieve through this stormwater rate study and increasing our stormwater rates so we can provide more clean water services. And now, with that information, we'd really like to hear from all of you. I think at this point, I'm going to once again thank you all for being here on behalf of the Clean Water Division. And I really look forward to using the rest of this time with you all to hear what services are most important to you and to take any questions that you might have. So I'll hand it back over to Haley to move us into the next portion of our agenda.
Perfect. Thank you, Devin. All right, so now's your time. If you have any questions, comments, go ahead, send them in the chat. We'll take a couple minutes to see which questions roll in, and then we'll go ahead and get started with the questions.
And Haley, I see that Connie has a question about capital projects. So I don't know if, Jeff, you want to field that one, and I can add to it if you like.
Sure. Yep. We can jump right in. Thanks, Connie. Good question. So when we do capital projects and really anything involved with the clean water program or division, it's on a countywide basis. So we do not collect fees for specific projects in a certain geographic area. We just have our revenue come in, and then as part of our capital planning, we adopt through council a 6-year stormwater plan, which is updated every year. And so some of those projects may be downtown closer to Salmon Creek, some may be out a little farther out. So, but it does not get broken down in a geographic way. Ken, you wanna add anything there?
Yeah, I just wanted to add, Connie, in case you're asking about our road projects, because those are our other kind of large capital projects that we do around the county, those do have a fee basis that comes from new development, not existing houses. And then also they're funded by the road fund, which is primarily supported by motor fuel tax and the grants that we collect or that we apply for. And so the only other development that you'd see, of course, a non-capital project would be if a developer is doing the project, but essentially those costs for developers are borne by the development, by the road projects, by the road fund. And then, as Jeff mentioned, if it's a capital project that's purely stormwater based, then we don't really have a district area that's applied to. It's just part of what we collect for the clean water fee, and then decide what to build in an area where it's needed.
And actually, Connie, I'll jump in one more thing. Thanks, Ken. That's true of repair projects as well. I know we've spoken, and I know you're referring to a repair project that we're hoping to do. So that's also true of repairs as opposed to just retrofits or additional projects we do. So it's all spread across the county.
And while we're waiting for more questions, I just wanted to kind of go back to that chart that, and you don't need to switch slides, but you can if you want to, Devin. The chart that we showed is on the comparison of rates to our other municipalities in Clark County. I just want to really give credit to our team here. As I said, they're small and mighty, but this idea that we could continue to keep the rate lower than anyone else is really quite phenomenal, especially if you see all of the services that are already being provided by this group. So I wanted to just give a powerful nod to the team, and also say, you know, we try to be very responsible for the dollars that we do collect. We're not here to make money, but we're here to provide services to support clean water. And I think, if anything, this rate study and the outcome has really shown that we can try to keep costs down, even though they have increased, and we've been doing more and more, as far as the power of the dollar, more and more with the same team year over year. And one of the things that this team was able to do was look and find additional revenues that weren't really being utilized for clean water that can be used. That's part of why this rate is low still, I think, comparatively, as well as leveraging our grant dollars as best we can moving forward on our forecasting. So just kudos to them. And then I see that Connie has another question there that I haven't read yet. So I'll let you guys jump onto that.
So Connie asks, how many years on average does it take to recover the cost of a project via clean water / stormwater fees?
Yeah, I can speak to that one a little bit as well. So typically we, in most cases, we don't have a cost recovery period. We typically have the money before we build a project. So we typically have to pay upfront, pay as you go. We do that through our annual revenues that we get from the current $47 fee, as well as all the rest of the work that we do. So it just kind of all goes into the same pot, and we parse it out as needed. So if we don't have money for additional capital projects, we typically just wouldn't plan to do them. The exception to that is that occasionally, very occasionally, we can go out and look for, say, a loan, a long-term loan, where we have one project right now that we're looking into that, where we would then have cost recovery over a period of, say, 20 years at a very low interest rate, to front some money through a loan for a larger project. So there is that option. We also aggressively pursue grant funding to try to offset the funding that we get through our rates. Hopefully that helps.
Another question here from Rachel. With emerging contaminants like 6-PPDQ and PFAS found in our local waterways, would the increase in funds be used to help the treatment of stormwater? Are you including education for the public on these and other contaminants? And what can people do to help protect the water? Kind of questions there.
I'm happy to take this one here. There are a number of emerging contaminants of concern in Washington State and throughout the whole country, really. 6-PPDQ is one of them. Some of you might know that comes from, that's a preservative in tires that comes off when you're just driving around from day to day. PFAS is another one that's, in a lot of different products that we use in everyday, from Teflon to like the nonstick pans to Gore-Tex jackets and things like that. And we're learning more about these chemicals every day. And we're also learning about different ways to try to remove them from the water. Some of the things like 6-PBDQ, from what I understand, there's some science that's pointing to the fact that rain gardens or bioretention cells can have certain soils, engineered soils, that can help to trap those pollutants, because that contaminant is toxic to coho salmon, and that's one way that we try to help it through some like structural built infrastructure. But I think you're really onto something there, that education and outreach is a key part of it as well. And yes, to answer your question, with all of these different suggested proposed rates, that would include some increased monies and support for public education and outreach to help let people know about what they can do to help try to keep some of these pollutants out of our water.
That was a great answer, Eric, and also a great question to Rachel. I will also mention that one of the new stormwater permit requirements that just came into effect in August was that our Clean Water Division team has to complete a PFAS inventory for the first time, as well as provide education on source control BMPs. We're also tracking 6-PPDQ very closely, and we're in early discussions about how we can be considering road retrofits in our capital planning efforts. And Eric, not to put you on the spot, but I do know you mentioned other contaminants, Rachel, that there are new stormwater permit requirements for us to also take a closer look at PCB source control and provide targeted education and outreach specifically to folks who may be power washing buildings of a certain age to help keep PCBs out of the water. So you are spot on, Rachel, that this request for a proposed rate increase targeting pollution and providing education and outreach is a major goal of our program that we are dedicated to working on over the next 5 years.
And Devin, if I could just add one thing to that, you know, we have a lot of stormwater filter cartridges around the county, if you're familiar with those. We use a few different technologies as far as the media that filters that water. One of the things that would be, and Jeff, you can tell me if I got this right, but I think it's probably in our recommended or maybe additional service categories, but not mandated, would be kind of a view to move towards more, a higher level of treatment in those stormwater filter cartridges, as opposed to just using what the base level of filter media would be. So, that's an example of one of the things the team is looking at.
Yep, and that is exactly correct, Ken. The changeover in those cartridge media is included in the recommended slate of services, and specifically those are the newer technologies are good at removing phosphorus, which is a important nutrient that drives algal blooms and some of the issues with harmful algal blooms that we're seeing in our local lakes these days. So that's one reason that we'd like to take that step to just enhance our removal of those fertilizers essentially from the stormwater before it gets to the water.
Awesome. All right, well, please feel free to send any other questions in the chat. You know, we've read everything that we've got so far. But we really do want to know what services are important to you. So please feel free to send us your questions. Otherwise, I may go ahead and turn it over to Devin.
Once again, I just want to thank everyone for spending an hour with us this evening. I know there are many other things that we all could be doing, but we really appreciate your interest in clean water services. If you would like to attend another community listening session, we will be meeting again in person this Thursday at Salmon Creek Elementary School, starting at 5:30 with our formal presentation starting at 6. So if you aren't available, please share with your neighbors and your friends. We would love to tell everyone about all of the great clean water services that our program is requesting council to support for 2025 to 2029. Additionally, if you'd like to stay up to speed, we invite you to attend our work session, whether that's in person or virtually. You're always welcome to give public comment or write a letter of support. That is on September 25th. And our final public hearing, where council will make a decision on whether or not to support a rate increase for 2025 to 2029, will be held on October 1st at 1300 Franklin Street at the County Public Service Center, starting at 10 a.m. And we welcome you to join. And once again, on behalf of the Clean Water Division, thank you for coming this evening to share with us what's important to you. And we look forward to providing clean water services in years to come. So thank you for your commitment to clean water, and thank you for supporting our work.